made in India, and it has a nice way of holding it, and it has different spots where you can hit it. And this is supposed to be the sweet spot. And it's iron rust has been put on here. So, different spaces, and you can just move it. With our children at the Brooklyn Society, and well, also at the New York Society, we're always thinking of ways to, you know, engage children. And sometimes everyone wants to talk at the same time, and sometimes no one wants to talk at all. And so we have sometimes we have a talking stick. And so at Brooklyn, we used to pass a talking stick around, and that way you could either say something or you could pass. And the freedom to pass for kids was always very powerful. But eventually, you know, the talking stick or the feather or the drum or whatever it was would make its way back around again. And the person who had passed inevitably would say something. But there was always one who didn't and was silent and just sort of was present. And I always appreciated the courage that it takes sometimes, you know, to be silent and to be present. So I'm going to pass this around, and it has a little piece of grass here, because I went on the labyrinth this morning. And I remembered that last year I also took a piece of grass and saw how long it lasted. And after a while it kind of dried up. And so it just reminded me that this place has become a home for me. It started with the American Ethical Union coming here for ethical education. We've had some board meetings here. We've just really made it kind of our home away from home for the ethical movement. And I'm so grateful for that. So, I'm going to start with you, Muriel. And if you feel comfortable sharing, what does home mean to you? Is it a person, a place, a thing?
It's not one answer.
Yeah.
New York is home to me. I love the city. Feelings closer than that. Home is whenever I'm with my kids or grandkids. Or with Bob, that's home. It's not a place, it's just a feeling. Mm-hmm. However, if I had to live in Kansas, it would be a place.
Starts, as Muriel says, with a feeling. And that feeling comes with the people with whom you share the space, whether daily or now and then. It's the place that you, that friends come to and that family comes to and shares with you. It's not, I don't think it's a home for me until there's family and friends involved. But then it's things. And I love to be invited to other people's homes and see how the home speaks for them. Are there family pictures? Are there things from their trips? Are there the books that matter to them? I know in my home that's always a part of it, but I've also been to what I call the decorator homes, where we don't want too many family pictures on the wall. It ruins the scheme, the layout. Home is you. My home is me. If someone came in, it speaks of who I am and what I'm comfortable with and what I need to be in touch with.
To me, home is my environment in which I have, over the years, everything in my home is something I have touched or I have personally selected. What I mean by that is nothing is something I thought was pretty for the sake of label or design. Everything, my paintings is something on the wall that someone personally painted that I know. Our artwork is an artist that I personally know. So everything there are little friends. And that's my home.
Home is easy to take for granted. Sort of settle in and everything seems natural and normal and how could it be otherwise? And so you don't really think of it as a place, it's just where you are. And that really got to be pointed out to me during a time when I was not home. When I was living in Europe for about a year and a half, trying to see if I could make that a home. And the difference was stark in a way. I mean, life was perfectly civilized, but it wasn't home. There was a certain vibration of the place that was different. You know, everything required some kind of translation. And it was very difficult to, at least as my experience, to actually fit in and make it a home. And at a certain point, I realized, yeah, I'm not really home.
I love this. I think it's great. I think that home, for me, it's two places. If I'm at peace within myself and I'm in a good place, then I can feel at home in many different environments. But on the other hand, for me, home is wherever my husband is. So if my husband isn't with me, it's like I'm not fully at home. Are we skipping you, Bob?
Well, I don't have to. You hold on to it. Home for me is my family and my friends, my community. And home used to be skiing and tennis, and I can't do that anymore. So I just have to take sailing and friends, family, and community.
Home is apartment 504, 517 West 46th Street. But home, that's where I feel cozy and happy. But I also think that home is wherever I am, wherever I stay. This place is home now until we leave. So home kind of goes with me.
Start with this. Well, I grew up in Minnesota, way up north in Minnesota, where my father was actually getting the trees to grow again, and ended up to be head of that state. Actually, we lived first in a long time. I had all my school was in Moose Lake, which was a small city, a village, relatively. And but I was very lucky because it was a very good place to get my school. There were the guy who was running that school knew how to where to find the teachers that would be so good when I got there. And they were really, really good. We went up to part of the next state, way up south, up north. Anyway, and then I went to college where my mom had in this down in this the state, and that was fine. But after I had been there for about 2 years, I thought, well, wait a minute, why am I staying here? At least I can go and see another place to go. And I went to New York and just visited. And they gave me a job to go working on one of those big boats where the families around Madison, and then in across in the boat on the other side. And that was wonderful. I loved that. And I stayed doing that for, I think about 4 or 5 years. Oh, in the meantime, I married somebody. And he was good. He was really a nice guy, except that you never knew what he was going to be doing or whether he was going to be there. I had a baby, and the baby hardly knew him because he would just come late back to where we were. And so I finally said to him, you know, we're not married at all, and we should change it. And so that happened. And then, I don't know, somebody said, well, there's a better job you should have. And I went over in the village, and the lady I was working for told me after a few months that she thought she would be working there all the time, but her husband said that they're going to another place. But she said, this is silly. You should just be going to the college there. So I did, and I got my degree there in the, whatever we call it. That's what I really feel foolish about. Anyway, the college right there on the edge of that big place. Methodist College, or was it nothing to do with?
Wasn't NYU or Columbia?
I'm sorry,
wasn't NYU or Columbia?
Yeah, no, it wasn't Columbia, because that was after.
Did you tell me NYU?
Yeah, and then, then pretty soon after I finished there and got a little bit of work, I said, well, wait a minute. Now I might as well go up, and I went up to Africa, up further up, and that was worked out very, very well. So for many years, I was first being taught there, and then I became a professor there, and that all worked.
So came up home.
Yeah, and. Then after so many years, I guess I don't think more than 3 years, or maybe, I can't remember already, might have been 4 or 5, but anyway, I said, wait a minute, this is silly, because I had been doing so much work, I would be actually traveling all around the world, which was wonderful. But then I said, okay, enough. I've been to almost every country. It's enough.
Yeah.
And I love being in a couple of places, but I managed to get there too.
So you made your home in New York?
Yep.
Wonderful.
Oh, that's absolutely.
Terrific.
Anyway.
Great.
And then I thought, well, I don't have to stay in the village when I'm working way up there. And so now I have a place right on the edge of
wonderful.
On
the edge of what? Wonderful. So let's hear where Pat's home is.
We're
going to pass it on to Pat, and we'll find out where her home is.
Okay.
So you have to get pass the drum along.
Okay.
Great.
I'm sorry. Thank you.
Okay. All righty. Thank you.
I guess.
concerned, home is where the heart is. And that means people. And I am torn now at a very late age of, do I go back to Britain and stay with my family, or do I stay in New York? And New York is home because I have met some wonderful friends here. I've been here since, what, 1952? And it's great until election time. Now I'm in a state of complete confusion. And recently, I had a 90th birthday party. And my nieces came from Britain and would like me to go and stay there. And what do I do? You'll know in due course.
To be continued. When I come back to my apartment, I say hello to every room that I own, and I greet all my goddesses, and all the, I say I'm back, and I say hello to every room, and that's where I'm home. I'm also home with him. I say
well, I really don't feel at home, and I. I was just trying to think about why I don't, and because I think it's because I should be in a full companion relationship where I live with somebody, and I always loved to live with a woman, and I did all my life, and it's very comfortable for me, and well, I can't, I don't have that luxury yet.
Yeah.
But that would make a home for me.
No, it was so lovely hearing all of your stories about home. I think I have a home, I have a house, I have a lovely family, wonderful husband, and when I drive upstate, Western New York, and when I see the first lake, there's something, I just, my heart skips a beat because I'm back home. And whether it's Canandaigua Lake or the Erie Canal, it's water for me too, I think. And it's not the house I grew up in, that's gone, somebody else owns it. They painted it a different color. They chopped down some trees.
Oh, yeah, no.
So I don't drive down Stafford Road anymore. But when I pull into Genesee Way, where my dad now lives, and his door is always open, he never locks it. And so when I walk in the door and I give my father that first hug and kiss, I'm home. I'm home because my father taught me everything that I know about loving, and about home, and about place a home, because what he does when you walk into his house is you see some model airplanes that he's put together that he's hung from the ceiling in the hallway. And in the kitchen, he's made a gallery of all the cards, not all of them, but the ones he particularly likes, of cards. So there are postcards in his gallery all over the kitchen. So whenever I send him something, I imagine where he's going to hang it in his gallery, where he's going to put it. So, home. Home is where one starts from. As we grow older, the world becomes stranger, the pattern more complicated of dead and living. Not the intense moment, isolated, with no before and after, but a lifetime burning in every moment. That's from T.S. Eliot, The Four Quartets. And I take those as inspiration this morning, and reminding us that we're born into homes of one kind and another. We've shared that with each other. If we're lucky, the place we enter is safe and secure. Loving arms embrace us, and a grateful community welcomes us. Our parents are good enough, as humanist psychologist Carl Rogers and D.W. Winnicott put it, and we are resilient enough to walk a middle path between chaos and rigidity, finding balance and harmony in our lives. We grow and we learn how to be the human beings we are meant to be. Next Sunday, we will be blessed with a gift. And that is our newest member, Athena, who has brought Phoenix into the world, will be sharing his baby naming and welcoming with us. So we will begin our platform with a baby naming and welcoming. And it's something that hasn't happened at the New York Society since I interned there in 2001. And we welcomed Brian, son of Teresa and Stephen, at the opening of a platform in the auditorium. So it's a special moment. And one of the things I'll be saying at that welcoming, so you get a preview, is a quotation from founder Felix Adler, of course. The love of the parent is the warm nest for the fledgling spirit of the child. To be at home in this strange world, the young being with no claims as yet on the score of usefulness to society or of merit of any kind, must find somewhere a place where it is welcomed without regard to usefulness or merit. And it is the love of the parents that makes the home, and it is his own home that makes the child at home in the world. And that's really the notion of that worth that we talk about so much. That worth, that before we are useful to anyone, before we have any merit of any kind, we have worth. And if we're lucky, we have parents and a community and friends, a hometown maybe, a neighborhood, that helps us to experience that worth in ourselves. And by their example, teaches us how to attribute that worth to others, and thereby create a home. How can we help those who are not so lucky, who don't have a home, whose home is disrupted? It's so traumatic to not have a feeling of at-homeness in the world. Originally, home meant the center of the world. Not a geographical sense, but an ontological sense. And Mercedes Eliade, who writes a great deal about the home and spirituality, demonstrated how home was the place from which the world can be founded. A home was established, he said, at the heart of the real. In traditional societies, everything that made sense to the world was real. The surrounding chaos existed and was threatening, but it was threatening because it was unreal. Without a home at the center of the real, one was not only shelterless, but also lost in non-being, in unreality. Without a home, everything was fragmentation. Every tradition has that sense of what constitutes home, at-homeness, reality, keeping the threatening chaos and unreality outside. Martin Buber and Kurt mentioned him yesterday, the book I and Thou, or Ich und Du, which is that sense of relationship that's intimate. He wrote a great deal and also shared a lot of Hasidic stories. And so in one of his collections, Where One Stands, I've often told this story, so you may remember this, but I love Hasidic stories because they're so rich and so grounded in reality, and also have come from a perspective that kind of is a little off-kilter. Mm-hmm. And when we have that off-kilter perspective, we're able to see things in a different way, I think, and appreciate them. So Rabbi Bunim used to tell young men this story when they came to him for the first time. And it was the story of Rabbi Isaac, son of Rabbi Yekel of Krakow. After many years of great poverty, which had never shaken his faith in God, he dreamed someone bade him look for a treasure in Prague, under the bridge which leads to the king's palace. But when the dream recurred a third time, Rabbi Isaac prepared for the journey and set out for Prague. But the bridge was guarded by day and night, and he did not dare start digging. Nevertheless, he went to the bridge every morning and kept walking around it until evening. Finally, the captain of the guard, who'd been watching him, asked in a kindly way whether he was looking for something or waiting for someone. Rabbi Isaac told him of the dream which had brought him here from a faraway place, and the captain laughed. And so, to please the dream, you poor fellow, wore out your shoes to come here? As for having faith in dreams, if I had had it, I should have had to get going when a dream told me once to go to Krakow and dig for treasure under the stove in the room of a Jew. Isaac, son of Yekel, that was the name. Isaac, son of Yekel. I can just imagine what it would be like, how I should have to try every house over there where one half of the Jews are named Isaac and the other half Yekel. And he laughed again. Rabbi Isaac bowed, traveled home, dug up the treasure under his stove, and built the house of prayer, which is called Reb Isaac Reb Yekel's Shul. Take this story to heart, Rabbi Bunim used to add, and make what it says your own. There is something you cannot find anywhere in the world, not even at the Zadok's. And there is nevertheless a place where you can find it. There is something that can be found only in one place. It is a great treasure, which may be called the fulfillment of existence. The place where this treasure can be found is the place on which one stands. This time, when I was reviewing, telling that story again, for the first time, and I don't know why it happened before, I thought of Dorothy. Dorothy from Kansas, who clicks her ruby slippers together and says, there's no place like home. There's no place like home. And she's transported back home, where she wakes up in her bed, and she sees her friends there. And yet she knows that she's been on an incredible journey that's taken her far, far away. And although she can't convince anyone else of that, she knows it to be true.
But she had her dog with her in both places.
She yes. did. She did. Right. So it was not only metaphorical or metaphysical, it was real. And it reminded me of all the journeys, and I was listening to you talk about your journey, and I too almost stayed in Germany and thought of making a home there. And it wasn't until I came back home with the person that I thought I would make a home with that I realized that not only was Germany not home, but he wasn't home. We need to find these things out, don't we?
In the next book that Frank Down wrote after Wizard of Oz, some years later, Dorothy takes her parents to Oz.
Oh, perfect.
So she says, home is where I take.
Mm-hmm. There's something called phenomenological architecture. And it may be similar to feng shui, I think. But one of these phenomenological architects, Kimberly Dovey, wrote about making a distinction between house and home. Mm-hmm. And she says that although a house is an object, a part of the environment, home is best conceived of as a kind of relationship between people and their environment. It is an emotionally based and meaningful relationship between dwellers and their dwelling places. And what I heard as I was listening to all of you is also that it's a place, it's an environment, but it's also people, very much that relationship. And I hear the struggle that you're going through, Pat, in terms of home. Because it's a physical place, it's an environment, it's also relationships with friends and the family. And although we might wish to clone ourselves, we can't do so yet. And so we really need to make a choice about where that home will be. We're lucky in many ways, too, that we have communication that allows us to stay in touch. And I know that you're in touch with Ernie every day, and he's your home too. We all have homes in the people, and the family, and the friends, the touchstones that we have. What Kimberly Dovey suggests is that there are different properties. The first of these properties is order, temporal, spatial, sociocultural. And it just means a kind of patterning in the environment, in our experience, in our behavior. Being at home is a mode of being whereby we orient ourselves within a spatial, temporal, socio-cultural order that we understand. Another of those properties is identity, spatial, temporal. It implies a certain bonding or emergence of person and place, such that the place takes his identity from the dweller, and the dweller takes his or her identity from the place. There's an integrity, a connectedness between the dweller and the dwelling. And I heard that, especially with Eleanor and Liz, in terms of your homes. You were talking about the places that you, the paintings, the art. And when you go into somebody else's home, I do that too. I love it when I get invited to someone's apartment. And I look around and I see, you know, what's important? What's the identity? Burnett going back home and saying hello to every room, saying hello to her goddesses, reconnecting in that way. The identity that we have in that home. I often think about that, you know, the painting by someone I've met, and where I'm going to hang that.
And you think of the person.
The person, exactly. There's a story with everything. Everything that the tangible story to it, that we can touch, we can smell, we can feel. And connectedness. People, place, past, and future. Home is a schema of relationships that brings order, integrity, and meaning to experience in place, a series of connections between person and world. That connectedness. Eve Ensler, who wrote The Vagina Monologues, and also did a wonderful program at Bedford Hills Correctional Facility for Women. There's a documentary that I showed before called What I Want My Words to Do to You. And she has a writing workshop with women at Bedford Hills. I know that you're going to have to leave, so that's okay. Eve Ensler writes, "My dream is that people will find a way back home, into their bodies, to connect with the earth, to connect with each other, to connect with the poor, to connect with the broken, to connect with the needy, to connect with people calling out all around us, to connect with the beauty, poetry, the wildness." Surely we've been connecting over this weekend with nature, with each other. That kind of longing, yearning that we have to create home all the time. It's a creative process that is part of being human. Maya Angelou said, "The ache for home lives in all of us, the safe place where we can go as we are and not be questioned. I long, as does every human being, to be at home wherever I find myself." I'm thinking a lot about the images of people we've seen walking all the way from Syria, sometimes getting on boats. I saw in the paper this morning that consumerism, stores are now stocking life jackets because those who are seeking a new home and running away from a home that's been destroyed and taken away from them need life jackets because they're risking their lives in vessels that are hardly seaworthy. So a whole new business.
The homeless people that we see on the streets, I see them all the time. When they carry, someone carries huge things, that's their home. These big bags of whatever. The other day I saw a woman with unbelievable amounts of bags that they carry on a carriage or something. And I always wonder if she really knows all the things that are in those bags. But if she does, if she doesn't, doesn't matter. That's her home. I guess it's like a turtle, so they carry their home with them. But it's very sad, but that's it.
And next Sunday, in addition to welcoming Phoenix into our home community, Mark Greenberg, who's the executive director of the Interfaith Assembly on Homelessness and Housing, will be joining us and speaking about what's happening now in New York City to help the homeless. And we do our bit, providing shelter for 8 women, usually an average of 5 nights a week in our shelter at the society. And we know that there are many people who prefer to be on the street, that that collection of belongings on the street feels more like home to them than to be in a shelter, because it doesn't feel safe, finding that place where we can feel safe. Nikki Giovanni, who is an African-American poet, activist, and educator, wrote this about finding home, moving from one place to another. The true joy, perhaps, of being Black American is that we really have no home. Europeans bought us, but the Africans sold. If we are to be human, we must forgive both or neither. It has become acceptable in the last decade or so for intellectuals to concede Black Americans did not come here of our own volition. Yet I submit that just as slavery took away our choice, so did the overcrowded, disease-ridden cities of Europe. So also did religious persecution. So also did the abject and all but unspeakable Inquisition of the Spanish. So also did starvation in Italy. So also did the black, rotten potatoes lying in the fields of Ireland. No one came to the New World in a cruise ship. They all came because they had to. They were poor, hungry, criminal, persecuted individuals who would rather chance dropping off the ends of the earth than stay inert, knowing both the body and spirit were slowly having the life squeezed from them. Whether it was a European booking a passage on a boat, a slave chained to a ship, a wagon covered with sailcloth, they all headed toward the unknown with all non-essentials stripped away. We think about, our families, where they came from. My paternal grandfather came from Holland. He would have starved, he said, had he stayed there, being one of 17 children. And my mother's Irish family came to dig a canal across the Empire State.
I'm just a small thought. I was thinking about my grandmother was the last of 13, the only one that was born here. So there were 12 before her, and when the mother came over with all the children, the youngest one was a baby. And to save the passage for that one child, she picked up her apron and pinned it into her waist and put the youngest one, the baby, inside the fold of the apron with some stuff in the front, and just hoped the baby didn't make a noise as they were boarding the ship. So so Tommy was never paid here or entered as illegal because he wasn't paid for it.
He still owes his passage.
Huh?
He still owes his passage.
He still owes his, right. Yeah.
Huh.
Home is where the heart is.
Yeah, well, that's what that's.
People who came when your family came and when mine had no expectation of returning. I know that you've been to Ireland several times, but I don't imagine that your grandparents maybe thought that they would get back or we're leaving. Surely my grandfather never wanted to go back. Never wanted to speak Dutch.
No.
Never wanted to think about the place where he nearly starved.
I don't know how it evolved, But my grandmother thought of those people as foreigners. And it in a negative way, I have to tell you, it became a line of demarcation. Those that were born there and those that were born here. And of course, those that were born here were the, what did the Moses people call? They were the chosen people.
Chosen.
The ones that were born here. And that's also, I guess, how bias and prejudice.
Yeah, you know, it's curious. It's curious. Both of my grandfathers probably came here about 6 years before they brought the rest of the family over, and it was like they kind of had to clear the way and make enough money to bring them here. And if they didn't come, they were going to be killed.
But that happens now still. People come from Latin American countries that are very poor, and they come and they work here and they leave their families and their children, and they try to make money to send back, and with the hope that someday they can bring them over.
But a lot of the people from Central America still call their old country my country. Mm-hmm. I always notice that when they talk about how their kids may still be in Guatemala. They'll always refer to Guatemala as my country. So there is some sort of nostalgia that they have for it, despite all the hardships that they've escaped from.
Well, that's
I think
their
it's
home.
Called the vision that
that's
that
their
is
home.
Their home. Mm-hmm. So there is a regret. I was thinking about during the World Wars, it was such an ethnic nation, there was always a question about the loyalty of various ethnic groups. Mm-hmm. So, of course, the Japanese had to experience their internments. And during World War I, when so much of the United States population was of German extraction, German descent, there's a question, which side should we really join? Which side of the war were we closest to? And, you know, so that's a lot of second guessing about what other people are really thinking of their home. Is it really the United States yet, or do they still have nostalgia for this old country that we're battling? So it turned out that, of course, the vast majority of Germans saw themselves as American.
One of the characteristics of this country, which I think is different from almost every other one, is if you were born in a country, you consider yourself a national of that country, as you point out. I am German. But the second generation, or the first, second generation of people who were born outside this country regard themselves primarily as Americans. I think that's a unique kind of thing. Because they've been transplanted and have accepted the change and have adopted the change that they've made. Whereas people in Europe and all other countries always regard themselves in German. Even if they move to another country, they identify themselves as members of the country they came from.
I think a lot of that has to do with how they're accepted. Because in America, we have such a tradition of assimilating people.
Yeah.
And accepting a child born in America is just naturally going to be American, even though his parents came from somewhere else. But in a lot of other countries, it's just not so. If you come from somewhere else, you're always marked as being a member of that other tribe.
And that's the distinction this country has almost every other country I know of. Because it's primarily people who have come from another country. But, you know, there have been, Muslims could be in a country and they identify themselves as Muslims and different than the rest of the country. But that's not a characteristic that we have groups that are different, but primarily they consider themselves Americans. And that is their home.
It's more than a passport, isn't it? And I know people who have multiple nationalities. in their passports. I mean, they have an American passport, they have ours as well, as your son does. So we are definitely citizens of the, global citizens, citizens of the world. One of my favorite columnists is Verlin Klinkenborg. And every once in a while, he'll have a piece in the New York Times. And he wrote something for the Smithsonian a few years ago called Be It Ever So Humble, It's More Than Just a Place. It's also an idea where one, where the heart is. So he asked the question, when did home become embedded in human consciousness? Is our sense of home instinctive? Are we denning animals or nest builders? Or are we at root nomadic? For much of the earliest history of our species, home may have been nothing more than a small fire and the light it cast on a few familiar faces, surrounded perhaps by the ancient city mounds of termites. But whatever else home is, and however it entered our consciousness, it's a way of organizing space in our minds. Home is home, and everything else is not home. That's the way the world is constructed. I'm remembering us last night sitting around the campfire and looking at all the faces that were glowing in the fire and singing together and telling stories and hearing about the constellations, having Kurt convince us that there was some kind of vibrations and energy in the in the stick that he passed around, and then, you know, sharing how it was a logic lesson for the teams that he worked with. You know, how could that be logically so? And around that campfire, you know, we had that home. We had that sense of all of us being familiar, eating together, singing, looking at one another in the fire. And how we can create that, how we construct home, what a creative process that surely is, and how we can extend home, how we can make the circle bigger. We can throw some more wood on the fire to make it warmer. And we do this all the time. It's a natural instinct for us. And how sad it is when there are those who would draw that circle tighter and tighter and exclude people rather than include them. And how it's our responsibility as human beings, as humanists, people who make this blue dot our home, to take care of one another, to welcome the stranger, to preserve the environment so that all can flourish. It's also the place where we know they have to take us in. It's the place where many people, if they're fortunate, go to die. And so I'm going to close with The Death of the Hired Man. It's a poem by Robert Frost. And it's a story, really. I'm not going to read the whole poem, just the ending of it. It's a story about the hired man who's very useful and has merit to his neighbors. And he is a hired hand for many of them. But after a while, he is no longer useful, and no one wants to hire him, and he has no place to go. So he goes back to this one farm where he knows they'll let them in. And so a husband and wife are in the bedroom, and they're talking about him because he's just stayed there. He's just come back. Warren, she said, he has come home to die. You needn't be afraid he'll leave you this time. Home, he mocked gently. Yes, what else but home? It all depends on what you mean by home, Of course he's nothing to us any more than was the hound that came a stranger to us out of the woods, worn out upon the trail. Home is the place where, when you have to go there, they have to take you in. I should have called it something you somehow haven't to deserve. We all hope for that place we haven't to deserve, but we can still go there. And so I end as I began, with that sense of even before we are useful to anyone, and before we have merit to anyone, we have a home, and our parents give that to us. Our community offer it to us, and they model how we make a home for others. And when we no longer have any usefulness to anyone, and no longer have any merit, there still is a home. And whether we deserve it or not, it's there for us. And it's in the heart of the community, it's in the heart of those that we've loved and cherished. And we come home to it. I want to thank all of you for being a home for me and for one another. And I invite us now to make our own circle in the center.